Lagless.
All right, so the stream is back up now. Sorry about that, guys. I didn't realize we were having some stream issues there. Normally, I stream on Twitch, and I've kind of got everything set up how I like it there. And so we're seeing the talkings here. Looks like we're about ready to hop back into picks bans for game two. UT Austin picking up a convincing win in round one. Very, very nice play from them.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, I mean, it's going to be really interesting to see how they follow up on that. I mean, we do have the team switching sides for this game, but oh, someone was calling their mom for Mother's Day. Aw,
Aw,
that's sweet.
Donald.
Everybody, do what Donald did. Call your moms. Tell them that you love them. It's Mother's Day. All right, now we're back into this. I think we're probably going to be seeing a Fiddles ban, a Blitz ban, or a Mordekaiser ban. Any of those would not surprise me in the least. Whereas at the same time, I didn't see any one champion really proving to be a gigantic problem in the same way that, that Fiddlesticks ult in was just such a problem in that game.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Fiddlesticks was just, oh my gosh, he was doing so much work. Every single time his ultimate was on cooldown too, he was finding something to do with it. He went down the bottom lane twice, where like literally the ultimate came off cooldown as he was sitting in the brush waiting for the opportunity to jump in. And I'm gonna see the Mordekaiser ban, the first thing going out here. And you know what? I have to say, that man, he farmed, and he farmed hard. He farmed really hard.
And then we're following it up with another Gragas ban. So obviously there is a Gragas player amongst our California Polytechnic team here, because we have had that Gragas ban, first ban, both games. And so I kind of want to see him not get banned just so I can kind of see what that is. But we've got that Mord ban coming up first, and I mean he was such a terror in those team fights, dealing so much damage, being so hard to kill. I mean that's really what Mordekaiser is for. He just kind of gets in the middle of the team fight and just wrecks havoc.
Yeah, and oh my gosh, but the thing is, he was dealing so much damage so early in that game. Like literally, he just had Will of the Ancients, Bellpin Boots, and he had a Negatron Cloak to help peel off some of the Ahri damage. And he unloaded on Nocturne, and Nocturne lost like half his health with just EQ. And it was like, oh my mercy, this is not gonna end well if someone doesn't stop this man's farm.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just want to go ahead and just point out the fact that we do have that Shen ban going off as well. So even though he was only present in a couple of those sort of those moments when he happened, I mean they did not enjoy it when Shen happened. I mean there are some people trying to get out of team fights and Shen just boom lands the taunt on them, and there's just absolutely no escape. Once the team fight happens, you've got the people who are low on health trying to pull out and come back in and do some damage, and he just lands that taunt, and all of a sudden you're just losing people that otherwise might have been useful. So I feel like Shen, he didn't play a big obvious role in that game, but if you watch those fights, he was going through and he was picking off all the low health people.
Absolutely, yeah. And actually, I'm going to make just a quick volume adjustment here. And so that will go down just a tad. And there we go. You can do a little bit more talking for me, Jeff?
All right, yeah, not a problem. We do have the Lee Sin ban coming out as well. And as we said earlier, Lee Sin's an extremely strong choice in the jungle or in the lane. So
Hello? Jeff? Hey, I think I lost you there for a moment. Oh no! Skype, why you troll me? Okay, let me go ahead and I'll just end this call and try to call him back real quick. Sorry about this, guys. I do live in Monterrey, Mexico right now, so sometimes Skype doesn't really like how far away I live from the US. And I know Jeff is in Blacksburg, Virginia right now, studying at Virginia Tech. So let me go ahead and give him the call back. See if any good things happen there. Hey, dude.
Hey, sorry about that. Looks like Skype died for just a moment.
Yeah, that Monterey to Blacksburg connection, just Skype's got to work on that line.
Yeah, they definitely need a little bit of work there. But as we were saying, let's see, where were we? We had the Lee Sin ban. We've got the Udyr ban coming out as well. It looks like I might have missed one. No, yeah, they skipped ahead. Oops. The real Kiwi accidentally got a little bit ahead of himself. We do have the Ryze ban coming out again. I mean, Ryze is an extremely strong mid, and just don't want to mess with that. And then there was Udyr as well. And as we said earlier, Udyr is extremely strong in all of his areas where he likes to go. In the lane, in the jungle, he's a terror no matter where he goes.
And interesting that it seems like Cal Poly is not really afraid of the Fiddlesticks. I guess they felt like he was not as integral to the success of UT Austin's game as we maybe did. They're going to go ahead and leave that up, and they took away the Mordekaiser instead.
Yeah, I think they might just be thinking that they might be able to counter pick that this time.
Interesting. Pinkboy, my mom wanted to watch me play Rise. Oh, man. You guys, you just took away that Mother's Day gift. I hope you're happy. I hope you're satisfied.
Oh, that is harsh and cool. All right, I'm going to AFK for like 2 seconds to just check something with my internet and make sure that it is running as it should be.
So take a look for Ruin My Mother's Day. Oh, so the first pick is going to be Janna. Janna, you're one of those champions that works just about anything. And Graves Blitzcrank going to be picked up here. They're obviously very, very confident in their ability to run a super strong Blitzcrank support. And honestly, after the last game, I would be pretty confident too. And I feel like Graves probably has just about as much synergy with Blitzcrank as any other champion does. Not only does he have the ability to reposition himself, much like Ezreal, but on top of that, Graves throws a smokescreen on you, and you have no choice but to assume that Blitzcrank is somewhere you can't see and about to pull you out, and you have to do something to get away. Like, you have to reposition yourself behind creeps. You have to turn and run. You literally cannot go in on Graves if you can't see Blitz, because you don't know where the hook's coming from. You don't know what kind of CC is coming up behind it. And it's just so terrifying. I mean, the smokescreen lasts, like, what, 3 seconds, 4 seconds even? He throws that down, and in that time, until you manage to make your way out, you can't take any action. And that's just what makes that combo so strong.
Yeah, and you know, not only that, we're seeing that, you know, they're against a Janna, so they know that she's not going to be providing sustain to her lane. So, I mean, she's got a little bit of that knock-up, a little bit of that disruption, but at the same time, she can't heal back all the damage that the Graves-Blitzcrank combo does. So if Blitzcrank lands a pull, Graves unloads on that AD, that AD's going to have to go back to base.
And an interesting pick here, they're going to go with the Caitlyn for the AD carry, and what that's going to offer is she's going to be able to use her traps to pick up brush control so that their support doesn't have to buy as many wards, because that was a huge drain on Soraka's economy that game. Literally, every time she went back to base, she had to buy two wards and end up warding both side brushes as the lane pushed back and forth so that they didn't have to worry about Blitz just kind of sitting in there. Caitlyn's going to be able to cut that down a little bit just by throwing all sorts of cupcakes in there whenever she has the opportunity to do it safely. And obviously, another great part about Caitlyn versus Graves is that she outranges him by a pretty significant amount. So she's going to be able to just use the auto attacks to harass as hard as she possibly can and force him to really pick his moments when he wants to quick draw in and make those all-in engagements happen. There is the Fiddlesticks repick. And Cassiopeia also being picked up here, and Theomancer is correcting the spelling incorrectly. I'm not sure what's going on with that, but we're gonna see a Fiddlesticks Cassiopeia ban here, or pick up here. Cass, obviously one of the safest mid picks in the game. She can farm against just about anyone. Her ultimate has an extreme amount. No, this is bad. Just gonna decline that real quick. Her ultimate has an extreme amount of teamfight utility in that in certain situations she can end up stunning just about everybody, and either way drops a lot of damage down right in front of her. And she's such a competitive mid pick. Not really surprised to see her getting picked up there.
Yeah, a little bit surprising to me, I guess, is the fact that we have that Nocturne pick again in the face of, well, we're gonna have a Fiddlesticks coming out. So I'm gonna be really interested to see if they go for some kind of early invasion, what they're going to try and do to keep Fiddlesticks off their case this game, because, you know, Fiddlesticks did help set up a lot of kills. He really did ravage that bottom lane.
Yeah, and what's kind of interesting about this is, like, conventional wisdom says if the enemy team picks Fiddlesticks, rush 5 people to their blue immediately. And that was not the strategy that ended up being adopted by Cal Poly. They were just like, Fiddlesticks, we're going to go take their, you know, we're just going to defend our Nocturne and let him pick up his blue. And, oh, I like that Jax pick.
I really like that Jax pick as well. In our last games on Friday, we have Jux and Lax. Yeah, we had a Jax go absolutely out of control. I would love to see that again. Jax is an extremely strong champion, especially once he starts going with that new ultimate after his most recent rework. You know, he builds a lot of aggressive stats, gets a lot of survivability, and you know that's the exact same thing with like Mordekaiser. That's the exact same thing with all those champions that can build damage and gain survivability are extremely dangerous. And we see that the pick against Jax there is Akali, going to be a real interesting choice there.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I haven't seen the Akali-Jax matchup since they were both like super, super OP up in the top lane. And there was quite a while there when that was the case. But, you know, now Akali or Troll?
I don't know if Akali is Troll to begin with. I'm not sure. We're going to have to see how this goes. She recently did get a buff to try and make her a little bit more viable in the top lane. So we'll see if that actually, you know, pays off for her or not. And then I really like that Lux mid pick, especially against someone like Cassiopeia, because, you know, Lux has got an extreme amount of range. And so as long as she's able to stay out of the poisons that Cassiopeia is going to be throwing at her, she's going to be able to harass with impunity.
Yeah, and what it's really going to come down to is, you take a look, I'm actually having a hard time keeping straight which team is which. So it's Lux, Jax with Nocturne, Caitlyn, and Janna. The thing about Lux is that you kind of need beefy people to sit up front and take a lot of damage while you sit in the back, toss in your E, use your W to throw up a shield, maybe try to find some picks with the binding, and then use your ultimate, and just kind of stay out of everything and just, you know, lob in damage with your spells. And Nocturne and Jax, They're going to have to get really tanky this game, and they're going to have to be able to take a lot of focus, because otherwise, you know, people are going to be trying to dive in on the back lines.
Streaming. Yeah, I mean, with Caitlyn and Lux as a combination, that is a combination of extremely squishy people who really, you know, they have ways to get away, but at the same time, once they've got people jumping all over them, it's going to be really hard for them to get distance quickly.
Absolutely, yeah. And so, caster's ready. Come on, have fun. And we are into Champion Select. We go ahead and throw up these old summoner blockers here. Good, everything is still lined up correctly. I was a little nervous when I changed the resolution that things might get a little wonky, but still looking good. Looking good.
Yep. And this time we can see that you know, we've got the quick wait while everyone's locking in, making sure they've got everything the way they want it to be, and then we'll start discussing these spells. Can't do that just yet. Even though it should be fairly obvious what people will be running. There are some nuances here I'm seeing already.
A couple of interesting things here. Real quick, I want to refer you guys to, you know, once again, check out ivylaw.com. Be a part of all this action. You know, don't just sit here and watch this. If you are currently enrolled university student at any, you know, college across the U.S., Mexico, Canada, I mean, all sorts of, I think Mexico. I said Mexico just because I live here, and I hope that's the case. But, you know, definitely check it out. Be a part of this. We could be casting you for the next semifinals. And Dire Wolfie, Puppy Rock,
yeah.
Crazy Lux rank stack. So the research department saying that a lot of Lux games on Communist Puppy here. So it could be very strong.
Yeah, sounds really good. I'm really, really happy for our men behind the scenes giving us this information. I'm going to be keeping a special eye on Lux. And then the one thing that I'm going to want to try and go ahead and, you know, just for everyone who's coming in late, who doesn't know who these teams are, we have on our blue team, we do have Cal Poly, that's California Polytechnic, versus our purple team, which is, you know the university, you know, UT Austin, University of Texas in Austin. So those are our two teams here squaring off right now, you know, and so...
Yeah, and if you are just joining the stream, sorry to cut you off there. If you are just joining the stream, I'm Malphus X. Casting with me here is Danya Harold. You can check us out. My stream is at twitch.tv/MalphusX. Danya, where are you streaming?
My current stream setup is on Own3D. I'm looking into another option just because I'm not too happy with using XSplit, but I'm still kind of toying around. But my Own3D is Own3D with Danya Harold. So you know, you can swing by and check that out. I'm going to be hoping to do a lot more streaming in the upcoming weeks, as soon as my schedule gets finalized, starting a new job, so I'm just trying to work out my kinks for that. But as soon as I've got that finalized, I'm going to be trying to stream a lot more regularly. Yeah, that's who I am, and I am over at Own3D.
So yeah, you can also find me on Facebook. Malphus X is the name there. And okay, sorry, I actually can't chat right now, but Malphus X on Facebook. You know, follow me there. I actually am not a big Twitter user, but I'm going to be getting into that more soon. And so you can, I do actually have it set up at Malphus X, so you can follow that, but really there's not going to be a lot of information on there. And, you know, more than that, definitely if you're on this stream, you probably came here because you have liked League of Legends on Facebook. Go ahead and go over to ivylaw on Facebook as well and give them a like so you can be, you know, updated on when new events are, when season 2 is going to be starting, and just so you can find out when you can see more amazing games like these. Check it out. IvyLaw.com is where you can find it. Register for to be a part of season two and find out more about this amazing league that sprung up. And I'm just gonna be nostalgic here for just 30 seconds, and we'll talk about this. I remember when Ivy Law was like a flash in the pan, like just when it was first starting up. I think I was one of the very first people to sign up on the forums and stuff like that. And I remember getting so excited. I was at the University of Cincinnati at the time, and I started like going around to like the e-cafes and around the area, Rocks Electro Cafe up on Calhoun Street, and I was like trying to find people to play League of Legends so I could try to get a team together. And just got so excited about it. My life ended up taking me somewhere else, but you know what? Here we are. I still am lucky enough and privileged enough to be involved with this awesome organization doing this amazing, amazing thing for the community. So definitely go to Ivy Law, go to Facebook, show them love. They definitely deserve it. So that's my diatribe on that. And that's a motorcycle driving by my place. Sorry, guys. So you want to go ahead and talk about these summoners we're seeing right here?
Yeah, I mean, they have swapped them around a little bit before they were, loaded in. We did see a Blitzcrank earlier running Clarity and Heal. He has gone ahead and dropped that. We do see that we have the Clarity on Lux. Not the Clarity, the Clairvoyance on Lux. It's just sound way similar. And that's an interesting choice here, because I'm still thinking we've got Lux mid.
We absolutely do. No, we absolutely do. Yeah. This is something that a lot of Lux players do so they can sight up their laser. Especially when they're like they suspect that someone's going to do a blue buff, or if they want to try to smite like a dragon or a baron or anything like that, CV can definitely help with that. Given the extreme range of the ult, it's not really cool to like try to get up there and then ward something when you could just CV it from a couple thousand units away and then drop the big laser.
Yeah, I mean that's definitely a good use for the spell. Sometimes you'll see that on the support, but it does free up a slot for the support. So, it's an interesting choice, one that I think probably is going to pay off well. I'm excited to see it in use. I have to wait for this loading screen before I can actually comment any further. But on the whole, we did see a couple really aggressive combinations here. Specifically on this Blitzcrank, we've got the mirror image with the exhaust ignite going down right there.
Yep, it worked for him last game. Why switch it up?
Yeah, I mean, so it's we switched up the teams who are running it. Actually, no, it is the same team. Sorry,
yeah,
I got myself mixed up for a second there. Sorry. Yeah, I mean, it worked last game. Keep it going. And then on the top here, we've got some very standard choices with the flash heal on Caitlyn, the flash exhaust on Janna. Our top laners, there are no teleports in this game, so there's going to be sort of a distinct lack of across map ganking there. But at the same time, Jax is running to win that lane. So is Akali with flash ignite for both of them. And then in mid, Cassiopeia's got that very standard aggressive choice of the flash ignite as well. So, I think this mid lane is going to be a choice of Cassiopeia trying to get on top of Lux and Lux trying to not have that happen.
Yeah, let me just apologize for that little black box that came up during the loading screen. That was me loading up XSplit so I could get the overlay up and doing it a little bit too soon. So it ended up, doing some silly things on the stream. Sorry about that, guys. But here we are, end of the game, and it looks like... wow. Looks like UT Austin is going to do basically the same thing, only this time they're going to rush for a blue invasion. And oh, both teams mirroring each other, both looking for an early blue invasion.
And, yeah, absolutely. We've seen this once before on Friday night, sort of the perfect sort of synchronization of both teams, just mirror imaging each other right here. And I'm just going to point out right here, while we're kind of in the no action phase of the game, that as much as I love Surprise Party Fiddlesticks, I am a humongous fan of Imperial Lux. I always play Lux with Imperial Lux. And I think Comrade Lux is just a great skin to have. So kind of just had to throw that shout out there for a personal favorite skin of mine. So both teams are waiting in the brushes, sort of in different locations here.
And at this point, I think they're going to realize, wait, oh, dude, they're at our blue.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, it looks like we've got the recall coming off of Jax here. They are going to go ahead and just take this because they're like, well, we're already in the neighborhood and we might as well.
And I think they're afraid of actually walking into this level 1 fight because this time it is substantially stronger from UT Austin. This level 1 fight is really strong from them. And, they're like, well, we can either go try to stop them at our blue or we can just let Nocturne do exactly what they're going to do and probably get a little bit ahead. And Fiddlesticks is going to go ahead and choose to take the enemy wolves as well. And oh, he's going to leave one up.
The troll jerk move there to make sure that the wolves do not reset. Nocturne will have to reset that manually.
Yep, absolutely. And Fiddlesticks, yeah, he's going to go ahead and smite that down. And will he do the same thing with the blue buff? Nocturne's being a good guy. He's going to go ahead and reset that timer right away. Fiddlesticks.
He's going to go ahead and reset the blue buff as well.
Yep. So everything going down. And I like that a little bit better than leaving it up because it provides you the timer. You know when it's going to come back up, and that offers you the opportunity to counter jungle.
Yeah, especially when you're playing someone like Fiddlesticks who's going to want to try and grab a blue, especially if your own blue gets stolen later in the game, having that timer is pretty important. But I'd like to notice here that Caitlyn did arrive in lane substantially earlier than Graves. She's already picked up 4 CS by the time he's able to get his first, and she's going to be hitting level 2 a lot earlier. So, you know, that does give her a very small advantage in the lane that she's going to really want against this combination of Blitzcrank and Graves.
On the flip side of that, that also means because she was there CSing before anyone else was, the lane is going to steadily push in towards, towards UT Austin, and that's going to kind of foil this Nocturne gank that's coming in here super, super early now.
Yeah, unfortunately, she did just reveal that the bush is warded to Blitzcrank by taking a pot shot at him while he was in that bush. So that was a little bit of a misplay on her part, because now Blitz knows it's warded. They can't set up any real gank on him in that situation. He knows that he won't be able to get away with sneaking around in there. So they kind of just did lose a little bit of a lane advantage.
Gank on top lane.
Absolutely.
Oh!
By that surprise party Fiddlesticks. Again, the combination of Terror and Drain is just something too much. I mean, the duration on that Fear right now is only 1 second, but right now that is a long time to be smacked in the face with that Drain.
Yeah, absolutely. Fiddlesticks just got right up in his face, feared him, drained him, and then, you know, when Jax was able to try to flash away and try to get out, Akali, did she run her flash? Yes, she did. She flashed and ignited, trying to make the kill happen, and realized that she was going to have to back out. Fiddlesticks went ahead and flashed in and put in the drain damage that he needed. Blitz getting a great hook on Caitlyn. They're going to actually force him to use her flash and summon her heal. She just absolutely panicked there. But you know what? She lived. So, is it really panic? Hard to tell. You
I mean,
decide.
They just landed face first into a Caitlyn Yordle Snaptrap there and took a lot of long-range poke. She's having to back out of this, getting caught by the Blitz hook, taking a massive burst of damage from Graves, dropping extremely low, and Blitzcrank accidentally steals that kill. You know, probably wanted to give that to Graves, but he just kind of punched her in the face to pick that up and just walked straight into a trap. Yep. And so that was a beautiful, just aggressive push there where they just walked on top of them and used that pull to make sure they couldn't run away.
Yeah, that
knock from King face first into Fiddlesticks here in the center. The Fear is going to go off for both of them. That drain damage is doing so much damage to Nocturne. The shield from Lux going off with that Ignite and the poison from Cassiopeia does pick up the kill there. So Cassiopeia is able to pick up that kill on Nocturne. And there's few things more scary than a bush with Fiddlesticks in it. You know, you thought Garen was scary. Well, now you've got Fiddlesticks. And good grief. I mean, you know, you're just suddenly CC'd so hard and taking so much damage.
Yeah, it was a little bit unfortunate there. Lux and Nocturne, they kind of stood right side by side as Fiddlesticks threw that Dark Wind out. And obviously, I think he's only got level 1 Dark Wind right now. Yeah, so it didn't really do all that much. But the fact that it just bounced between the two of them was able to take Nocturne low enough that Cassiopeia's poison was able to kill him with just the very last tick of its existence. Man, that was just great play there by Fiddlesticks. And, I have to say, Entheomancer is showing why his Fiddlesticks is, I mean, so widely respected. And you know what? I think it should have been banned.
Yeah, I think that the Fiddles going unbanned was probably a bit of a mistake here. Because right now I'm feeling like the champion composition for our purple team is better. The one champion that I'm really going to be looking for to kind of really beat his lane right now is Jax. Lux, I think, has got a good opportunity here as well. But, I mean, right now it's just kind of like those are the two lanes where they're really going to be looking to win right now. And then jumping in on top of Akali right here with Jax. However, walks face first into a Fear from Fiddlesticks, going the long way around. Akali not really willing to chase that. Fiddles trying to keep him caged up. Uses the Counter-Strike, jumps on top of Akali, gets hit by that Twilight Shroud for the slow. And he's just going to have to run right out of it. You know, luckily she did not have her 6th up, but that would have been a lot of damage he would have been taking that he really couldn't escape from.
Yeah, well, I mean, Jax, if she hadn't Twilight Shroud right then, Jax just would have straight up killed her. Like, that's what he was looking to do. When he popped that Counter-Strike, he was like, well, I'm pretty sure I can kill Akali before Fiddlesticks can do anything to me. He just uses Fear, so it's down. All I have to do is get my Counter-Strike to stun her, and then jump on top of her and hit her with an Empower Shot, and that's going to be it. She's going to go down. But, you know, Akali, great play there. As soon as she saw that Counter-Strike and she was like, oh, he's going to get on top of me, threw the Twilight Shroud down, kept herself nice and safe from any of that happening.
We see that Blitzcrank is managing to walk into all of these traps on purpose to just make sure that these bushes stay clear.
Blitzcrank love cupcakes.
I don't even think he can eat cupcakes.
You know what? Why do you have to be so racist against great steam golems? That's all I'm going to ask. Every time there's a great steam golem in a game, you have to make some sort of derisive remark. What's up with that, man?
I don't know, man. I don't know if great steam golems come with eating functions. I mean, they come with giant fists of grabbing people, and that's kind of a plus, so... I don't know. I feel like the abduction function on Blitzcrank is kind of enough to make up for his inability to eat cupcakes.
So as we take a look here, let's take a look at the CS across the map. Lux sitting at a lovely 47, and actually Cassiopeia right up there along with her. Look, Cassiopeia has managed to pick up a kill. The Lux CV, did it spot this? Did it spot Fiddles going for this super fast dragon?
I do not think it spotted this at all. The 7-minute dragon is going to be completely uncontested. They've got no wards here, and they're just going to go ahead and pick up a free dragon. I think they're severely underestimating how quickly Fiddles can start taking these map objectives. Fiddles can force those extremely early dragons.
Mid lane.
Early barons.
Oh, Communist Puppy dodging all the poison. He's going to be able to keep himself alive. And up in top, will Akali fall to the Ignite? Yes, she will!
Jax, however, is also dropping to 71 health. If not for that health potion, he probably would have died there. So, really close exchange there. I mean, absolutely frightening for both of them. Cassiopeia going top to try and make sure that this tower doesn't take any damage. Unfortunately for her, Jax did retreat, so she won't get a free kill, but... You know, she's going to get a lot of farm up here with these, you know, this really big minion wave that she was able to clear out.
And Lux going to go ahead and pick up the blue buff, walking away with 92 HP there. Just a bit frightening.
I'm just going to go ahead and add to this that, you know, right now we see that the bottom lane is going to go ahead and be kind of what we expected.
Sorry.
With Graves and Blitzcrank being able to bully them around really, really hard. You know, right now, Caitlyn's sitting at 52 farm. Graves is at 66, and he's also got an assist up on it.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, this lane is going really, really well for UT Austin once again. It did a lot of work for them last time, doing a lot of work this time. They're kind of in an unfortunate position where I think Blitz is trying to help Graves freeze the lane, but his ultimate passive is ticking on these creeps, and it's going to end up pushing it back anyway. So Graves kind of like, well, I guess it's time to just farm everything.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, do you think Fiddlesticks going to be able to pull off this gank? Here comes the ultimate. Akali diving in. Fiddlesticks jumps right on top of him. The fear goes off, and Jax is going to go ahead and try to run away.
Akali's using her ultimate to stick to him, however, is able to use the Crescent Slash to pick up that kill as he's trying to flee into the bush.
Oh, Janna, you are a dead, dead floating lady. Blitz with a fantastic hook.
All over the map right now. Nocturne not trying to do any jump in. He does not have the mana for his ultimate right now. Just barely able to, you know, have any mana at all. So he's not able to jump in and try and, you know, salvage that for the bottom lane. So a little bit of a misplay by him to be so low in this stage in the game.
That was just a great Blitz hook, you know, leading into the Blitz knockup into Graves hitting Buckshot in his ultimate, and, you know, Janna just melted. She literally didn't have time to do anything.
Caitlyn right now with the Buckshot coming off. Tower aggro going on a blitz, Nocturne coming in to chase them away. Not going to want to stick around for this though, 1v2, he is going to lose to that. So he's just going to go ahead and back off and, well, I don't know, maybe Blitzcrank has like a mouth in his foot that he uses to eat the cupcake. I'm not sure.
He just walks up, beep, beep, boop, eat the cupcake.
Yep. I mean, there's something charming about Blitzcrank. We do have Lux picking up the kill solo against Cassiopeia in the middle. Really nice there. However, Jax and Akali are trading up top. Not exactly sure if they want to keep fighting or not. You know, Akali's trying to just do those combos. However, Jax jumping in with the empowered leap strike, taking out a quarter of her health in a single hit. Akali's having to feel really cautious right now. You know, she feels like she's the one who should be bursting for that much damage, but instead Jax is just beating her senseless right now.
Yeah, and if he gets another counter strike off, she's going to die. Oh my gosh, taking her down so low. 135 HP walking away. And she's kind of like, I don't think I can even stay here. Oh, Nocturne's going to find her.
Nocturne's coming in from the side. Gonna just waste the ultimate on that, you know, guaranteeing the kill there. I mean, almost not necessary at that point, but he just wanted that kill, you know, come hell or high water.
Well, he knew as soon as she saw him that she was gonna drop the shroud. So he knew he had to get on top of her and get the burst down before she could, you know, press W and click on the map. And he knew the best way to do that was just going to be to go ahead and ult, hit her with the Dustbringer, and just hope for some red buff action.
From Fiddlesticks onto Jax with the immensely long fear, and then, you know, going to be able to get out of that using the Leap Strike onto a friendly minion. You know, that's a really versatile skill, really good. We see that Caitlyn is having to keep dodging these Blitz Fists, you know, near miss after near miss. in the bottom lane, you know, if not for her, you know, really well-timed 90 caliber net, that would have been a lot of trouble for her.
Absolutely, yeah. And, you know, see, the Blitz has pink warded this brush. He's trying to be as aggressive as he possibly can, trying to absolutely terrorize this Caitlyn Jonna lane. Because, you know, once he's in this brush and the pink ward's there, they have to assume that he could be at any single part of that brush. And that extends his zone such an insane amount. Like, the grip can go to about here. So from there all the way to out here, he has them zoned away, where they have to be cautious about grips.
Yeah, absolutely. Nocturne's ultimate still on cooldown for, you know, a little while yet. So he's got another 80 seconds on that. So he's not going to be able to come in for that sort of across-map gank anytime soon. Trying to plan a gank here on mid, or potentially going to take this blue. He's pinged it. They do know that this is going down. Smite does pick that up for Fiddlesticks, however, when he sees the Clairvoyance. So not going to run any risk of getting counter-jungled there.
And Caitlyn going to walk away with just a scant 83 HP. Looks like, yeah, Graves did pop his ultimate. I'm not sure if Blitz led that off with the hook. But, yeah, Blitz's Ignite is down. They were just about able to take her.
But, and this turret is almost assuredly going to fall here. You know, the Tornado from Jonna does manage to knock up Graves. She does waste the shield, but I don't think that's going to be enough. Jax just solo killing Akali up top.
Yeah, he. These lanes are so much burst everywhere. Not only is there action, but it's just like so much burst. Like one person jumps on top of another one, and then it's just an insane amount of damage going down.
Yeah, it's like almost an instantaneous kill, you know. You see the red light flash, you're like, oh gosh, action, and they're already dead. We see that, you know, Cassiopeia is trying to pressure Lux here. Lux is using that E to farm extremely well, however. You know, once you've got that leveled up a bit, once you've got some ability power, you can actually clear caster minions in a single cast.
And so, Fiddles is going to go ahead. He's looking for the opportunity to jump on Jax again with the ultimate, but he's like, you know, it didn't really work out last time. He's still pretty tanky. I don't think it's going to work out this time. Just going to walk around and do a little farming.
Now he's got the tower down to 285 health right now, so Jax is looking to try and finish that off, but he's not going to be able to finish it with Fiddlesticks there.
Yeah, Blitz going to go ahead and drink his Oracle, make sure that there's no wards on the dragon, and he's going to go ahead and pull aggro. And Cassiopeia and Graves going to be able to take this down fast, quick, and in a hurry.
Say, Lux is on the wrong side of things, going and getting her blue buff, not in position to try and steal this. Nocturne also on the other side of the map. They have no way to contest this, so this is going to be another dragon going to UT Austin.
And I kind of have to wonder if that was called out. Like, if they were like, all right, guys, their blue is going to be up right now. If they, you know, they're going to have their jungler and their mid, who has the ability to snipe a steal, up there. You guys just go ahead and just go take it. You got it.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, there's the Clairvoyance going down right now, just a couple of seconds too late from Lux. So that must be extremely frustrating to have the blue, have the mana, be ready to shoot, and oh, man, Ominous lost.
So yeah, and I want to point out, Fiddlesticks did a great job of smiting down that blue buff, because as soon as he saw CV, he knew what was going on. He was like, Lux is looking to laser this and pick up the steal. I need to make sure that I smite this very, very accurately. And sure enough, he was able to.
Yep, absolutely. And we can see that, you know, the CS right now, you know, Cassiopeia does have a very slight lead on Lux. About 10 creeps, you know, part of that's picked up when she was roaming her lane. Jax jumping on top of Akali up top, having some really intense trades here. She's staying aggressive, so that's kind of tipping Jax off that, oh gosh, Fiddlesticks is right there, because, you know, otherwise there's no way this Akali would keep fighting me. So, I mean, he is sticking around, you know, Fiddlesticks is hiding right here behind the turret, you know, trying to be sneaky, unleash his surprise party. But right now, you know, Jax is playing this a little bit cagey, looking for the gank.
Yeah, absolutely. He drops a ward down here, but unfortunately for him, oh, he does spot Fiddlesticks just in time. He's going to turn around and walk away from this, and Fiddlesticks, his ult's going to end up clearing a wave and nothing else.
Yeah, and you know what we saw there, especially from Jax, you know, with Akali trading, is that, you know, he knows he's going to be able to beat Akali. He has a ward in there, jumps in on top of her, however, Fiddlesticks is still there. The Counter-Strike is not going to land on her, and she's able to, you know, jump in on top of him and pick up that kill.
Yeah, that was actually the flash. Yeah. Yeah, great heads-up play by Akali. They're able to pick up that kill. And this top lane is illustrating something that I want to talk about really briefly. And, you know, just to go ahead and say this. This isn't something I came up with. I'm pretty sure I remember hearing Chaucer say something about this on a stream one time. There's no such thing as CS benchmarks. Like, yeah, there are levels, there are numbers that you would like to be at for CS in certain amounts of time. But sometimes the lane just becomes so much about harassing or about countering harassing or, you know, about whatever it ends up being. That you take a look, you look at Akali and it's like, oh man, she only has 59 CS, she's losing this lane so hard. Then you look at Jax, it's like, he's only 20 CS ahead. Like, yeah, he's ahead, but, you know, you would look at the Jax and say, 79 CS, 17 minutes into the game? That's nothing. But he's beating his lane opponent. It doesn't mean that they're playing badly. It just means that this lane has been more about aggro and trading and fighting each other than it has been about farming.
So we can see that, you know, Blitzcrank trying to get a gank in the middle. He keeps coming in with the speed, really wanting a gank, and not being able to land one on Lux. Lux is playing it really cagey, using her range to harass. And, you know, Comrade Lux does not want to be caught up in a close-range fight right now, and she's being really, really cautious about it.
Absolutely, yeah. This check.
You can see that she is preparing each minion for her E before she lets it pop, so that way she makes sure she gets all of the CS from each wave.
Absolutely, yeah, and that's exactly how you need to
and
play.
And Jax is jumping on top of Akali, doing a bit of damage. Unfortunately, he's kind of lost a bit of that crushing lead he had earlier, so he's not able to burst her down in a single go. But he does keep just landing these trades, and Akali's really starting to feel this. Fiddlesticks is hanging around close, though, with Blitz and Graves coming up the river towards him. Jax knows this is happening. Lux has kind of tipped him off there, and he uses the Leap Strike to her to just get out of that, you know, before he gets completely destroyed by a four-man gank.
Yeah, great job there getting out of that, and Caitlyn needs to shove right now as hard as she can. I don't know where Caitlyn's going. I mean, you're going to be too late to get the top lane to help anything out. You just need to shove bottom, take this tower down, and get all the CS. So, yep, top tower will go down for UT Austin, and that will extend their gold lead up to, you know, just over 5,000 gold. And you see Caitlyn is now, you know, in the middle lane. And looks like she's going to make the pushings here. Kind of interesting. Cassiopeia actually dropping a ward on the enemy red buff. Going to provide them with a lot of sight in the enemy jungle.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Caitlyn's just looking for anywhere she can farm right now, because she is currently down by about 30 farm. So, you know, she's trying to catch up to Graves as best she can. You know, Graves does have two assists up on her. So that and that, you know, little bit of a farm that she has, 30 farm, that's going to extend the farm lead to about 40. So, you know, Graves really is sitting pretty with a pretty substantial amount more gold than her right now.
Absolutely.
And she kind of knows it.
And let's take a look at his gold count. He has Infinity Edge in his pocket right now. And, yeah, he's going back to base. Here comes the 19-minute Infinity Edge. You know, Graves, you know, his damage output just jumped up an insane amount. And you look at Caitlyn, she only has the BF sword, and she's only got 600 gold in her pocket. So she's a long sight from getting that BF sword for herself. And that's what two dragons from your team will help with, big time.
Yeah, as well as two turrets. You know, that's four map objectives going down. It is about 4,000 gold. So it's a pretty substantial amount to be picking up for a team. So that's why you really kind of want to keep your pressure on those dragons, because 190 gold per team member adds up very quickly over the course of the match.
Yeah, absolutely. Take a look here. Graves is going to come down just in time to pick up the overwhelming majority of this farm for himself. Take a look here on the map. Blitz using that Oracle to go ahead and clear things away. He got a little scared there. Saw Nocturne coming in through that the other ward they had higher up on the river and was like, I don't want to risk it. And left that ward alive. He's going to roam around and he... did he spot it? No, that ward actually far enough in the blind spot that Blitz did not see that ward when he came down. Lots of pings going down on Dragon. Looks like Dragon's about to respawn. And, you know, Blitz does have the Oracle, so that he knows that Cal Poly has no sight on this.
And they're going to go ahead and pull it out and get started. And so, you know, Lux is going to go ahead and try and move into position for that steal. The Clairvoyance is up. They just threw in the ward right now. Pop the Clairvoyance, and the laser does go down. We've got the Nocturne ultimate in. He's going to die pretty much immediately. Trying to see which team picked that up, however.
That was Fiddlesticks.
I think. Was that Fiddlesticks?
Yep. Yeah, he was able to pick that up with his smite.
Actually,
right,
Nocturne was the one who blew the smite there. I think Nocturne did actually succeed with the steal.
Oh, really? Oh, wow.
Yes, I actually think that was a steal for Nocturne. The only smite burned right now is the Nocturne smite.
And wow, Akali 1v1ing Jax and using her abilities, bust the Hextech Revolver, keeping her alive. Unbelievable. That was crazy. The Ignite was ticking on her. She was 100% going to go down and making the smart play, just pounding away on the creeps, using that spell vamp to keep herself alive. Great play there by Akali.
Yeah, absolutely. That's one of the strengths of Akali as a champion. She's got so much built-in sort of spell vamp, but once you get something like a Hextech Gunblade, she's got her passive providing her with 15% spell vamp. Stack that on top of the 20% from your Gunblade, and Akali by herself has got 35% spell vamp at this stage in the game. That is incredible. That's basically a double Lotus stack. for herself.
And just imagine if Cassiopeia does decide to pick up a Woda as well.
I mean, it's just going to get absolutely out of hand exactly how much lifesteal and spell vamp that this Akali is going to have.
She does have another amp temp for herself. I'm going to assume that she's looking to build that into an early Rylai's. Well, not necessarily early, but she's going to look for the Rylai's next to give herself some extra sustainability. And also, you know, if you can make your Q slow, it makes catching up to people and actually proccing it that much easier and that much more effective.
Yeah, absolutely. And as well as that ultimate, you know, landing on someone and slowing them with that ultimate is going to be pretty huge. She's running face first into Jax here. He's going to go and drop the Counter-Strike, land the stun. However, he can't follow it up with a lot of damage because of that Twilight Shroud. You know, Jax really needs to get some pink wards or something so he can try and, you know, deal with that in these exchanges. And Akali can just retreat to the bush, you know, use her ultimate to keep juking him around and wait for some help to arrive. However, Nocturne is going to come popping up from the side here. You know, Counter-Strike lands. The fear tethers are on her. She's going to get feared while inside the Shroud. Ultimate coming out from Fiddlesticks. All of a sudden, Jax is melting. Nocturne is melting. And all of a sudden, the entire team is up top with Cassiopeia dealing out a little bit of extra damage to help finish off both of those kills. Lux going to just throw in an E, you know, sort of that sort of gesture of rage, trying to deal a little bit of damage there. And they're in position to take this Baron.
Yeah, I think she really wanted to scout that out and see if that's where they're going. So we're going to see our second 23-minute Baron of the series. And I have to say, I don't know if Caitlyn and Lux are going to be able to stop this.
Especially because Lux's clairvoyance is currently on cooldown with another 36 seconds to go. Throwing the ultimate way too early. Not a chance of a steal there. And this Baron is definitely going to be going to UT Austin.
Absolutely, yeah. I kind of feel like Caitlyn maybe should have tried to get some, like, while Lux's E was down, maybe try to just go ahead and ult someone so that they could maintain vision on Baron and offer Lux that opportunity. Like, she threw the Lucent Singularity down right in front of the entrance to the Baron Cave, or the Baron Cove, excuse me, just so that she would have sight and try to use that in lieu of her CB. Caitlyn could have provided her some extra sight by throwing down the Ace in the Hole ultimate on somebody who was standing near the Baron and just give them that much more vision. But unfortunately, it just didn't work out for him that way.
Yeah, and right now, I think they're really ruining the fact that they did not ban out this Fiddlesticks. He makes these early Barons and early Dragons possible. And that's really part of his strength as a jungler, is not only does he have some pretty frightening ganks, he has just such control over the map objectives, the ability to threaten them so early. He's kind of like Warwick in that regard.
Yeah, and his teamfight presence is just ridiculous. I mean, that's always the thing about Fiddlesticks, is that especially, and one of the things is it really provides is Baron control. If the enemy team goes for Baron, and you can get a round of ward on them, you can typically ult on top of five people almost every single time. And if you have a Zhonya's, you know, that's just going to be huge damage on them and nothing on you. But, you know, obviously this, you know, both these games, UT Austin has been able to establish an advantage and maintain the upper hand and use that to actually pick up the Barons for themselves.
Absolutely. Would you say that Lux is going to go ahead and pick up her blue buff, trying to keep, you know, that mana regeneration and the cooldown reduction on her, because she really does need CDR is a very important stat on Lux, you know, especially, you know, a lot of times Lux will even pick up the blue elixir, you know, and keep it up throughout the game, just because, you know, you absolutely have to keep yourself able to throw out your spells in team fights, because, you know, apart from your burst, you're kind of, you don't have anything, you know, once you've thrown it all out there. So, you know, with a lot of CDR, you know, your ultimate becomes extremely spammable. You know, it can get down to about a 30-second cooldown. So, you know, I'm really happy with their decision to keep the blue on Lux throughout this game.
You know, I'm kind of concerned with the fact that the team fighting phase has been delayed so long in this game. I feel like the longer they wait, and oh wow, a very nice light binding there, and oh, Akali's actually going to try to flash in and jump in on Lux. The Janna Tornado knocking her way up into the sky. Akali's going to
get... I actually was a little bit amazed by that. Blitz slightly overestimating her escape there. However, the ultra comes through the wall from Cassiopeia as well as Fiddlesticks. Suddenly, Nocturne, Janna, and Lux have all died in just a burst of ka-ka-ka death. I mean, that Crow Storm is doing about 1,000 damage as of the last time I checked. Yeah, still doing about 1,000 damage. Actually, a little bit more, doing about 300 a second for 5 seconds. So that's actually picking up to about 1,500 damage right now, coming off of that Crow Storm. And that's just absolutely unstoppable. We've got Caitlyn and Jax trying to defend these turrets here. Blitzcrank trying to land these hooks. Caitlyn having used her 90 caliber net to escape. Both turrets are going up.
I think that's
going to
be the series right there.
Be the game.
Yeah, that, wow, absolutely dominant performance from UT Austin here at both games. And, you know, if you have to call an MVP, I have to say this Fiddlesticks has been pretty strong.
Absolutely amazing ult coming off here. Fiddlesticks having to burn his Zhonya is going to get melted down immediately. All of a sudden, the respawn they were not expecting. Two members are down. Cassiopeia is extremely low. Jax is trying to chase here. They might have a chance to get back into this game if they can take some objectives while they're down. Using the leap strike onto a ward, trying to close the distance. Blitzcrank using the knockup. All of a sudden, a lot of damage getting dumped onto Jax there. Janna knockup, jumping onto Cassiopeia, getting the kill. Janna ultimate there. Little too late to save Jax. Blitzcrank is sticking around while Graves picks up the kill on Janna. Nocturne closing in, getting obliterated by this Graves. Graves is doing so much damage. Lux unloading her full combo, picking up the kill there. The Caitlyn ultimate comes out, not required. And then Blitzcrank is running for his life. Caitlyn ultimate is coming out this time onto Blitzcrank, dropping him extremely low. Communist Puppy just waiting for her ultimate to come off cooldown. 5 seconds left on that. And, you know, Blitzcrank is kind of juking around, realizing, wait, there might be an ultimate coming out here. And, oh, she's way overestimating his ability to dodge out of the way. And he's going to pull in with the E, and that is a mutual death there.
If you kill Lux while Lucent Singularity is down, I'm pretty sure it pops it. I think that's what happened there. Either that or she was able to pop it right as she died. But Blitz embracing her in a death grip as she pulls him to her to give her a little great Steam Golem hug, and they end up both dying. Akali jumping on this Caitlyn and melting her down in about half a second flat.
Let's say, and that's why you don't feed Akali. Once Akali's picked up some kills, she turns into a one-woman melting machine, and she's just going to go ahead and just abuse these minions and try and just beat down this turret really, really quickly. And Fiddlesticks is just going to go ahead and take a dragon by himself. Not a problem.
Yep. He's just, he's got that, wow, he's actually got a revolver. He just has that much spell vamp. His drain is healing him that much. Yep, Akali pushing this down. Wave dies. 190 gold. Akali gonna do a little laughing there. Think something's funny, young lady? Let's take a look. How much gold does Fiddlesticks have in his pocket? He's got 700 gold. What's he gonna turn that into? He's gonna turn that into some double elixirs, I believe. Or just some single elixirs. Those work too.
Absolutely.
Oh, he finished the Woda. Elixirs
are a vastly underused aspect in this game. A lot of people, especially at lower ELOs, don't buy elixirs, and they're extremely gold efficient. Cassiopeia throwing the ultimate onto Jax, however, he did manage to turn his back at the opportune moment, so all he got was a little bit of a sunburn instead of a sudden trip to being a piece of lawn stack, you know, statuary there. Got totally tongue-tied with that. But, you know, really kind of has to run for his life right now. Graves, Blitzcrank, Akali, Cassiopeia, all of them are muscling in right now.
It looks like they're just going to dive the Nexus. This reminds me of that Tree Eskimo game.
We've got a jump in out of nowhere from Nocturne onto Jax. However, the ultimate from Fiddlesticks is going to go ahead and melt Jax pretty harshly. Cassiopeia's burst finishing the job. Massive amount of damage coming out of that Lux ultimate. However, Fiddlesticks will survive with his Zhonya's. Lux getting melted down by that Akali. Nocturne taking a massive amount of damage. Janna melting to that Akali. Graves dropping extremely low, getting picked off. Akali diving the fountain. Then Caitlyn getting picked out by Blitzcrank. Nocturne escaping, taking a lot of damage onto that Blitzcrank with the fountain as well. However, Nocturne is trying to heal while this Nexus is taking just such a beating. He will not be able to save this, and they're going to go ahead and pick up this game.
Yep, there it is. This semifinal going to UT Austin, so congratulations to them. Really nicely played by Cal Poly, but I have to say the Fiddlesticks play and the team coordination from UT Austin, you know, just putting them that much over the top.
I'm just going to go ahead and say if we have an MVP in this in this series, it's got to be Fiddlesticks. I mean, the way that he was able to give that map control to them with control of Dragon and Baron, and then on top of that, how he was able to just do so many successful ganks. He did so much damage in those team fights. We've got a 2-1-12 Fiddlesticks in this game. I mean, it's just...
Yeah.
I think that was definitely needing a ban after that game one.
Yeah, so ridiculous. I mean, the Blitz just absolutely teared the bottom lane. Caitlyn was completely unable to farm. Although, you know what? Look at it. She did end up going to 210 to 253. So she was able to you know, get quite a bit of CS there by the time the game ended. But while Graves was in the lane there, she was having to really respect that. And whenever they didn't, bad things happened. Janna would get picked up. Caitlyn would get picked up. And, that's just how a really aggro lane like Blitzcrank Graves goes. I mean, every single time. But UT Austin going through to the finals. They will be meeting UC Irvine this coming Saturday. Once we are able to talk with the teams, we will have the time for those games, and we will publicize that and make sure that everyone knows exactly when it's coming out. And Jack's actually picking up a stinger there at the end. I don't know if he was really going for an Asher's Tooth or if he was just like a Phoenix Codex as well. I think he's just like, all right, game's over. Time to buy whatever I feel like.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes you just get those items where you're just like, well, I don't know. I've seen some games end where, right as we lost, right up until the last minute of the game, it was a very reasonable build on our Graves. He had an Infinity Edge, he had a Bloodthirst, and suddenly the game ends and he's got five Boots of Mobility and a Phantom Dancer. And I'm like, okay.
Oh, okay. So I'm trying to find out who we've been able to track down for some interviews here, post-game interviews with Mr. Walter Wolfie CJ. Well, I call him CJ, but yeah, Dire Wolfie here.
I say I stick with Wolfie. It works for me. I don't know. I mean, it makes me think of Husky, and they both ends in Y's, and they're like dogs and stuff. So it kind of works for me. I don't know. I like Wolfie. Makes me
Yeah.
think of a plush toy almost.
Saying they haven't been able to ask since they've been in game. So hopefully we'll be able to track down some interviews here. It looks like Ivy Law Chill is gonna maybe be able to talk to somebody. I think he's got some contacts on both teams. So hopefully we'll be able to get some people in here for just a moment. For anyone who isn't gonna stick around for the post-game interviews, which I really, really wish you would, because we actually had quite a nice little conversation with UCI and with SUNY Stony Brook on Friday. If you aren't going to be sticking around, however, thank you so much for tuning into the stream tonight. Another huge showing from the community, and just showing exactly what League of Legends is all about and why this mobile game is definitely here to stay. The teams tonight, great games and just a lot of great action to watch. And so glad you guys were here to share it with us. Once again, I am Malphus X. Casting with me is Danya Harold. You can check him out at own3d.tv/. Is it just Danya Harold?
Yeah, just Danya Harold.
Okay, and you can check me out at twitch.tv/MalphusX. You can find some VODs of some earlier games from the tournament, mostly UCI playing on my channel, and all of Penguin's in. Oh, nice, cool. So we'll be able to get, hopefully my Skype won't go, crazy. Could someone else host that call in case something awful happens again? UCI playing against University of British Columbia, and actually their semifinal game from last Friday as well are there. If you want to see more VODs from the Ivy Law Season 1 tournament, or just from Ivy Law Season 1 in general, check out Dire Wolfie stream, own3d.tv/DireWolfie. And he's got all sorts of VODs. He's been doing so much casting for Ivy Law this entire season, and that man definitely deserves some props for the work he's done this season, and definitely deserves some publicity as well. I've been casting with him a little bit. Very fine caster. And actually, I just want to go ahead and give it up as well for the co-caster I've been working with here for these events, Danya Harold. It's been awesome casting with you, man. Really, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, absolutely. I've really enjoyed casting with you as well. I'm looking forward to any more casting events we're able to do because this has been a lot of fun. I mean, we only got set up, originally doing this. I got to cast with Vietri Eskimo, which was a lot of fun. But, this has been a really great event. And I feel like absolutely this is, you're a higher ELO player than me. I'm one of those 1300 scrubs. You're up in the 1900s. And so, it's been really helpful having your insight on, a lot of the stuff that I might not have picked up on. On Friday, I thought that, you could hit Olaf with a Vayne, judgment and like knock it back. And apparently you can. So, I learn new things all the time when I cast with you. So this has been a lot of fun. And absolutely, this has been amazing showings from all the teams. Like,
Yeah, and honestly, the only thing that's left to say is I can't wait for the finals.
yeah, like these finals are going to be spectacular. After seeing UCI play, I thought there's no way these guys can lose. But now after seeing UTI Austin, I don't know. Like, it's like this is going to be real interesting with UT Austin versus UCI. This is going to be a really incredible finals matchup.
Yeah,
Like, if you're going to
absolutely.
be around next Saturday, you've got to tune into this because, like, after seeing both teams in action, I'm going to say that both of them are absolutely top tier.
Yeah, I mean, just fantastic play from them here. So excited to wait. So,
So I do have Chill asking to get pulled into the call and to make some announcements. So if you can go ahead and do that.
well, actually, like I said, I'm gonna have someone else host the call because the last time I did it, something really, really horrific happened with Skype, and basically everything ended up dying, and you couldn't hear anyone else. So I think, are we trying to get, we trying to get Cal Poly in first? Is that what's going on? Are we trying to see the Slowbros first? Is that the thing? Wolfie, are you making some Skype callings? Yes, no, hello? Could anyone send me the message? Okay, so Wolfie is confirming. He's setting up the call. Give me just one second. So while I have everyone's attention, why don't I just hijack you all, take you to ivylaw.com. You know, come check it out. You see Premier League Final Four right here. So we did see UC Irvine did come out on top over SUNY Stony Brook Seawolves. And they will be going down to the finals. And actually, we're looking at the Open League here. You know, these guys definitely deserve some props, too. Arizona State going up against Georgia Tech. I actually haven't been able to follow that. So I don't know what the status of that is. I don't know if we're actually ready for the finals there as well. I don't have the schedule with that. People just kind of been telling me stuff that I'm going to be casting. But you check it out. Go to the forums. Forums are always good. They have all sorts of information up here. The standings, you can see where everybody is in the Season 1 tournament as well. And, you know, check it out. You can see a lot of teams from all over the place. You see, you know, Penn Girls right here at the South. And, yeah, basically just check out the website. Look at it. Go ahead, log in, sign up, find your team, find your school. And you know what? You should be in the next semifinals. You should be the one we're sitting here talking about and killing dead time.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm just going to go ahead and point out, I did check by the general discussion chat for this event. And, I mean, there's a lot of the pride in here for UT Austin. You know, that everyone's throwing their hook'em horns, which I'm especially fond of because we had a Blitzcrank hooking both games. And so that's just extra awesome. I'm just going to go ahead and say. So mad props for the Blitzcrank for the school representation there. That was extra, extra special to my heart.
Aw, yeah, that's cute. So let's take a look here. Just kind of waiting. Just showing up here. Taking a look at the chat. Should be an alumni league. That would be interesting. That's an interesting thought.
That would be an interesting thought. I mean, I don't know. I mean, definitely add another layer, I guess. I mean, I think it's pretty interesting. We've got the number 4 seed team and the number 2 seed team coming up for this final. So we've got some unexpected, you know, upsets that have come through in this, but I must say, you know, especially with the California Polytechnic, you need to go ahead and give them a shout out. They were the 11th seed in this, and for them to have come this far deserves a little bit of praise. I mean, you know, they beat some substantial opponents here on their way to this semifinal, so I do want to give them a bit of praise for that.
Yep, and I'm going to go ahead and end this call, and we're going to move into the interview call here. So, just one moment, guys.
Hello,
hello.
I mean, hi, go for it.
Hello.
You're using my mic. Use the mic from the back.
Hey, guys.
Hey. Very, very loud. Hey.
Sorry.
As you can tell, they're very together right now. They're celebrating.
Uh-huh.
You guys can't help yourselves, can you, huh?
Nope. Yeah, we can't.
Too much energy.
Okay. Energy. Mic test. Is this better?
Okay. Sounds good.
Yeah.
Is this a better mic?
Okay, cool. Thank you. Okay. Thanks, Mary.
Wait, flip it around.
I don't know how to use this.
Thank you, Paint Mother. Wow, don't break my mic.
It's Mother's Day.
Hey, Mother.
It's Mother's Day. Well,
bro. Don't send that. I don't want to have my headphones on. Dave, do you want to come do this?
Bruce, guys. Take a deep breath. Take a deep breath.
Oh, are we that loud? Should we turn down the mic sensitivity?
Sorry. Hey, Wolfie, I'm going to hop on and do some announcements before you do your interviews. I think Dash will join me too. It'll take like a minute.
Alright. Yeah, the built-in mic. Yeah, just use the built-in mic. The built-in mic is working fine.
Okay.
As long as nobody yells and nobody talks softly, it'll catch up. Okay.
I really like how you only have a mini fridge. Like you have a real
tree.
You have someone within the car right now. But that's a fridge that's left over.
I'm not saying that now.
Before, so it's kind of a legitimate fridge.
You guys are sexy.
Whoa. Hey, guys.
You guys.
All of you.
Yeah, see, like, the video is catching pretty good. So yeah, we can give him Donald's mic.
I'm actually going to go ahead and sorry, I'm going to go ahead and leave that call real quick. I was asked to just go ahead and hop out for just a quick moment while they kind of get their ducks in a row. Obviously, as you can tell, the mic, they just had like everyone kind of crowding around one mic, and it was just coming out like really, really loud and kind of hard to understand. So ivylaw.com, I'm actually, let's take a look over at the Facebook here. So I'm AlphaZack, so it looks like, okay, getting some messages, getting some stuff here. So oh man, just look at Riot go. Look at Riot do work. Stream is so bad. Haters. Haters gonna hate. There's always gonna be haters. post a nice little message on here. Yeah, very nice. And, you know, also if you want to check it out, there is a Reddit post as well. If you look in Reddit and search for Ivy Law, I think you'll be able to find it. And, yeah, I'm just kind of looking around here. Could go ahead, minimize this down. And actually, let me go ahead and find that Reddit post. That would probably be wise. I think I still have it on Skype from earlier. If I can track it down, it's probably going to be like way, way up here, though. Let's see. Nope, that's not that link. This link. This is the one that I want. So yeah, if you could go ahead and find this, you know, upvote it, you know, make it look good, and that way maybe maybe next time when we put the post up for and Riot Jaws, oh look at that, put a little red post and everything. Maybe next Saturday we'll be able to get a little bit more publicity here from the Reddit community. Obviously that's another community that we would love to have involved with these games. But you know, a lot of times unfortunately it seems like we do miss a few of those. Yeah, I can't hear the stream now. Really? Can you guys not hear? Can everybody watch it? Let me find the owned chat, show chat, join chat. There's, still hear me? Oh, wait. Oh, no. I'm not actually able to join. Oh, no. Take a look here, Steve. It's good on my end. Okay, cool. Okay, cool, cool, cool. So I'm getting confirmation that it is still working. That scared me a little bit. But and unfortunately, I end up breaking the IRC connection by trying to pop it out and then, you know, it not working. But so, yep. I can hear the stream. I had Skype up. That was muting the stream. Oh, okay. Man, stop throwing me in all these wild goo chases, dude. You're going to make me lose a couple years off my life. Going to have a heart attack. So let's see. What can we do while we wait to get into these interviews? I want to do a video interview with them. We need 1v1 on Skype. Maybe let's not try this on the fly in front of 1,900 people. Intriguing idea, though. Won't be calling me lame. I'm like, I don't really want to try out new technology and new things in front of 1,700 people. But, running it. I'm not even in. Asking if Matt's all finished. Oh, I see. Hang on. I'm sorry. Hey, Matt, sorry, once I stop derping and realize what people are actually wanting to have happen, I'll go ahead and call you so you can talk to the stream before we jump into the interview.
Oh, yeah, it's totally cool. We were just I set up the interview over there, and we had Skype open, so we couldn't hear what was going on the stream, and it was, like, two completely different conversations.
But, yeah. So, actually, okay. Wolfie's calling for me. You want to go ahead and make the announcements?
Yeah, sure. First off, just wanted to say thanks for everyone who tuned in. Thanks for Riot, who posted from like their official Facebook page, which I mean, got 3,000 viewers in maybe 2 minutes, which was incredible. Also, thanks to the casters. Check them out at twitch.tv/MalphusX, own3.tv/DireWolfly, and own3.tv/DanyaHerald. Also, Ivy Lol has a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and you should definitely check us out. We're on Facebook at facebook.com/IvyLolEsports and on Twitter at twitter.com/IvyLol. And we have like a kind of big announcement that we have an upcoming alumni tournament. It's at the end of July. We'll be posting details soon to our homepage, our Facebook and Twitter. We're going to have a mix of current players and alumni of the universities, and we'll be duking it out, and it should be a lot of fun. And that's all I got.
Okay, cool. In that case, I will check and make sure that Wolfie's ready for us over here. Ready for me to come in. And and actually, let me just go ahead and say on behalf of both myself and DanyaHerald as well, thank you so much for inviting us to come and be a part of this tournament. I can tell you that it has been an absolute blast so far, and I cannot wait for the finals on Saturday. And did I just say all that to nobody? No? Matt, you still here? Hello?
Yes, sir. I had my mic muted.
Okay. Okay, cool. So, yeah, thanks again, man. And I'm getting the go-ahead from Wolfie, so I'm going to hop on in.
Yeah, let's go right over.
All right, bud. And join call. Hello, hello. Yeah.
Reveal my body. All right. Take it down a notch, guys.
Hello, hello. Welcome to the stream.
Hi.
Hello.
Okay. Thanks for having us, guys.
Of course.
So, Wolfie, who do we have with us?
The entire team of University of Texas at Austin.
We're all together here.
They're quite a tight family. You guys, if you guys want to give a little help, shout out to the stream, go ahead.
Hi, we're Pain Girls.
And
I'm the girl.
We don't actually have a girl on the team.
Shout out to my mom! Shout out to my mom! Shout out to Pain Boy's mom.
Happy Mother's Day.
Okay, so...
So what's up?
By the way, I do feel like mentioning, I'm sorry, Pangboy, that your mom didn't get to see you play Rise. I'm sorry about that. That was heartbreaking to all 4,000 viewers. There were a lot of QQs going down for that.
Can't do it.
My mom was really looking forward to it.
Yeah. She was crying.
Oh.
All right. So you guys were going into game one. The first thing I have to ask, did you guys do any homework for this team? You guys do any research on the champions, what they were strong with?
Nope.
Yeah, well, we had a guy who helped us out. He did a lot of scouting on the team prior to the match. His name is Mufang. He's actually here right now. Yeah.
I keep that bench real warm for my team right there.
Yeah. So he did some scouting there, and we did look at their previous game that they played in the IBLL bracket, and we looked at some of their picks. We knew that they were going to prioritize Lee Sin. As a pick, so we made sure to ban that one out. That's about all of the scouting that we did, in addition to looking at the profiles.
All right. So those picks and bans come into play. In game one, because you guys definitely have a couple of niche champions that a few of you guys are exceptional on. We know Entheomancer is pretty well known for his fiddlesticks. You know, Donald loves playing Blitzcrank. And almost every single time we see these champions pop into one of these games, you guys absolutely roll it. So seeing that they weren't banned out, you guys just were like, yes, free win?
Well, we always lose our first game, so...
Yeah, we're working on
five. We're just really confident. It's not more like free win.
Yeah.
Just, well, great, because they're really consistent and efficient with the set champions, so...
Wait, I'm sorry. Did you guys say that you typically lose your first game?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
We always lose the first game.
This
is the
first 2-0 we've had.
Yeah, this is the first ever 2-0 because.
So well, the question has to become: what on earth is going to happen when you guys go against UCI in the finals, who have historically also been a first loss team?
It'll be a draw.
It's gonna be a tie.
It's
like we're gonna show up 30 minutes late.
Dude, whoever surrender faster will win the series.
Yeah. I think that's what it's
going to be. So the finals is a throw-off. Is that what it is?
Yeah. Just the first game. Just the first game.
Whoever loses the first game will win the next two matches.
We're going to run both Twitch and Eve the first game.
And Shaco.
Oh, man, take notes. This is important.
I hope he's got his notepad out.
Game one, you guys played really well. Your bottom lane matchup. It was actually kind of rough. You know, Ezreal Blitzcrank, have you guys done that before? It seemed like you were having a little bit of trouble getting some coordination between the two.
I believe mostly it's because Babes is a very he's very top tier AD right now. In Korea, whenever they have to, when they play the last match, they do blind pick, and it's always a Graves versus Graves bottom. And he's probably one of the, like I said, I will restate. He is the strongest AD carry right now in the game. So, I mean,
it's Twitch.
So it's just really hard to play around him, and especially with the Soraka. So,
all right. And of course, game one, you guys after a certain point, it was kind of obvious you guys gained a lead. And at one point, did you guys decide to make the call to do a sneak Baron?
Yeah, that's the thing that I'm in Theomancer, that's the call that I make a lot. So basically when I'm playing Fiddle and I have when I get to a point in certain point in my items, I'm pretty good at tanking it. And we had Blitzcrank with an Oracle, and he was able to scout around the Baron right before we did it. And so we were pretty sure that we were safe doing that Baron. And it was kind of risky because during the Baron, Pangboy got engaged on by their Nocturne. Mm-hmm. So there, he was fighting the Nocturne while we were Baroning. And we just, I told him to just say, keep DPSing it. Because I knew they didn't have any wards there. And Fiddle makes for a pretty safe early Baron.
Yeah, it was kind of funny. You guys gave him the old Kansas City shuffle there. It was, you know, you had Mordekaiser over there distracting him on the right side while you guys were over there hitting him from the left side.
Yeah, we actually told Pangboy the Mord to just like go away.
go back to it, stop.
don't bring him over here. No, yeah. He doesn't want to see it.
At first he was running towards us, and then he just flashed back into the bush, and then that was good.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure when they saw Mordekaiser in lane just pop up with Baron buff, they had a moment of like, crap. It was like, man, we didn't see that. And that's when they realized Surprise Party Fiddlesticks was really bringing the surprise.
I think they realized it whenever Baron was at 1/5, because Graves, he was farming bottom, and all of a sudden he just started walking towards Baron. But at that point, it was too late.
It was probably related to the map, just being gone for so long.
Yeah.
All right, so, yeah, because game one, you guys, after a certain point, it was a pretty downhill fight for them, or downhill match for you, because you just continued to roll them after team fights. But, you know, going into game two, you start with the bans. Are you a little surprised that they actually didn't prioritize banning out Blitzcrank or Fiddlesticks that game?
Yeah, I'd say we're pretty surprised.
Yeah, short answer, yes. Long answer, no.
I missed a lot of folks.
Yeah, we thought for sure they would. They usually do ban out either Blitz or Fiddle. I was pretty certain that they would ban out Blitz, but I guess we got lucky.
And as far as your team is concerned, I'm a little intrigued by it. Why the Akali pick versus Jax?
okay, we'll let him answer.
It was either Akali or Troll, so they had to.
Yeah, this guy, he thinks that Akali can beat Jax.
But
apparently not.
Well, trust me, I got this.
When he picked that Akali versus Jax, he basically picked into a lane where it's really snowball dependent. So, like, whichever champion can get the advantage is going to have a huge advantage after a few more minutes of farming. So, when he died to Jax, I had to camp his lane, basically, the entire game. But we were able to actually, he was actually able to pull a kill off of Jax after I camped his lane for a long time, and he was actually able to snowball back into the advantage in that lane, which was pretty good. But it was a pretty risky pick, I think. But this guy just wanted to Akali, honestly.
Yeah, that's
really like female characters.
we were up 1-0, and we thought, why not?
In worst case, you go into game three, right? So again, in that game, you guys managed to get Blitzcrank on top of it. You also managed to get Graves for that combination bottom. So were you guys like high fiving each other at that point?
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
best possible outcome for bottom lane.
Blitz is a very strong lane. We're very comfortable with it.
No, and again, no, because they did these bans, and then they had first pick, and they prioritized Janna over as opposed to maybe trying to take one of those champions away from you, which again, really in the long run hurt them because the bottom lane, especially once you guys got your hand on Graves, it was just Blitz Coke, and somebody was dead, and you guys continued just to rush that. Interestingly enough, though, and I feel like bringing it up because you don't see it too more, it's more of old school, the clairvoyance on Lux mid, how did you feel about that objective pressure she was offering? Was it an issue for you guys? Did you like, did you have a couple panic smites on a buff to make sure she wouldn't try to steal it?
Wait, she had a CV?
we weren't really worried at all. Like, I don't think CV had any impact.
It's actually better that she had CV over Ignite, because it made mid lane a lot easier.
Ignite's
pretty scary. I think Ignite's better.
Yeah.
Teleport's actually
better. Teleport's pretty good on Lux.
I don't feel like she utilized the CV very effectively, though, so I don't think it was very much of a problem. It might have been a problem.
Without Ignite, I could just push mid and then threaten to kill her, and then we got Dragon that way. So I can force objectives while she can't because she's playing really passive.
Do you guys feel there's anything in game two that maybe they could have tried to do? Or like, were there any misplays you guys might have made? You're like, well, this is a bit of an issue, and now we got to play a little back to catch up. Or
like, Donald, don't hug. Mostly just the Akali dying. So Akali actually misplayed a few times in lane. And that hurt him a lot because he died in lane at one point. And he didn't really have to die there because he already had the advantage at that point.
I think, mid and bottom both won without our jungler helping them. So basically, top just got carried.
Yeah.
So. I think what they could have done is they knew that Fiddle had a camp for top, and then they could just focus all their four on bottom. That would have been a pretty smart decision. But I think Nocturne just tried to counter gank, which kind of stalemate. And I actually think my team, or the top lane won. Oh, Akali and Fiddle.
Okay.
The duo lane.
Yeah. Nocturne was pretty far behind me in EXP at some point. I don't know what was happening for him because I was like 11-8 at some point. I don't know if he was not farming that well or something. I know he was giving his blues out a lot.
He kind of kept mid after he lost red buff because he got caught. I'm sure you guys remember. He got caught at level 4, and he died and gave me Cassiopeia red buff. So then I knew right away he would try to get it back, and then he did because he just went past the ward and he sat there for a good like 30 seconds, and then he was just really behind.
All right, is there anything else worth of note you guys feel like mentioning? Something important about those games or?
All right. We just want to give one big shout out to Bojang, who's actually owns a house that we're all chilling in.
We're squatting
yeah,
in.
He
actually left for work about 10 minutes ago.
He's our private sponsor.
So yeah, big shout out to Bojang.
His living room.
That's
what
we owe him a lot.
He's taking over his living room.
He uses computers.
There's no sofas. It's only computers.
He paid for our dinner once.
That's true.
Good guy Bojang. Nice.
Yeah, good guy Bojang.
Mal, maybe you want to take a couple questions from the chat.
Definitely.
If anyone has something here for these guys.
Absolutely, yeah. And the one question I want to ask before we turn it over to the chat is, and this is something I meant to do on Friday, if you had to pick one player from the enemy team to pick as their MVP from the series, who would you guys pick?
The team that we just played against?
Yes.
Oh my god, Scotty. XP.
Yeah, their top player had the most presence.
Yeah, their top player had a lot of presence.
Okay, so there it is, folks.
Yeah. And kudos to the Lux for winning a man fight. She killed me once solo.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That was really good.
Well, one time.
Well,
it never happened.
It hardly happened, so I was pretty impressed.
Oh, this guy.
Look at this guy.
That's a shout out to UCI right there. to their mid player.
Oh man.
So the first question, first question coming out of the chat here. Why were you guys banning Gragas?
Okay.
That's a good question.
Short story. So I guess like Tim already gave you like long story about like, our analysis and I guess like our bans, but honestly, so we banned the same three champs, both games, and they were actually just the top played of the Scotty guy.
Sorry,
Scotty.
Scotty didn't know. Scotty just didn't know.
He didn't know.
He did know. I'm sure he did.
I do have a. There's a question for Entheomancer, and Bob Vader wants to know who he should play in order to carry himself out of the 1400 Elo.
Who do you think? I don't. If you want to.
No, actually, Bob Vader is coming.
I know.
I promise I'm not a spy for any other teams. Don't worry.
To carry himself out of the 1400. Like Leona support?
Let's be your best.
Of course. Big, big, big endorsement for Blitzcrank support.
So are we gonna get a straight answer or?
Yeah, I said Leona.
Oh, Leona.
Leona.
Okay.
Interesting.
As a jungler or as a support?
No, a support. You have to use her as support.
Okay.
Yep.
Jungle Leona is something I'm seeing more and more of. A lot of people are actually really enjoying it, including actually the co-caster for this series, Danya Harold. He thinks it's just swell. But someone's asking, who has chips, what kind, and can I have some? It's actually kind of a major point of contention because I've been seeing a lot of comments about chips on the stream here.
What is
no one's eating. We're not eating.
I don't think anyone has.
No one's eating anything. The entire stream, you guys are all crazy. Every single one of you.
Oh, man.
No, not really. Just the people who are talking about chips.
Wait, is it this?
Wait. Oh, that's Velcro.
That's Velcro.
It might be Velcro.
Tim was playing with it the whole time.
Somebody want to munch on some Velcro sneakers there? No? Oh, okay.
No.
I have one person asking, what's the better rune setup for an AD carry? I'm assuming they're talking about maybe the advantages of running like armor pen reds over physical damage.
Unless you're going for a really hardcore, like you know what you're doing, kill lane, which is, if you do, then you want to run like full armor pen, just no doubt about it, because you get 10 more, you get 10 more armor pen than attack damage if you do the full armor pen rune page. And that just helps you kill heroes faster, of course. But a lot safer, and it's great, is just a full attack damage. Attack damage reds and quints, armor yellows, and depending on your lane, magic resist blues, flats, or levels. If you went for flats, it would be like against Corki or like Tristana, you know, like kind of mixed damage ADs. But you want magic resist per level against like maybe Graves or Varus, who are just strictly attack damage. But yeah, you just want to, because it helps you CS a lot better with the attack damage rune page. Uh-huh. And with CS, you can snowball better late. So there you go.
Okay, so physical damage for farming and kind of standing off and harassing, and then armor pen for going really, really aggressive and trying to pick up kills.
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions from the stream? I think we'll take maybe one or two more. I have a lot of people asking if they can take you guys out for drinks.
Sure. I think only one of us is 21, but...
Sure you can. And we actually have one person on our team who's never been drunk before, and he's drank like 10 beers in like,
nope.
In like 10 minutes before.
We're not going to condone underage drinking on the stream.
Okay. No, he's
overage. He's overage.
Okay.
You can only take him. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't drink.
Yeah, we only have one overage. Yeah, that's the guy who drinks. He says he doesn't drink.
Okay, I'm actually going to go ahead. I think that's going to be about it there.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks for coming on with us, guys.
Yeah, it was great having you. It was great watching your games. Thank you for letting us watch that amazing series. You guys are just outstanding. And really looking forward to see you guys play in the finals.
We are too. Look out, UCI.
Bye-bye.
Hey,
bye. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, guys.
Hey, good luck.
All right. So UT Austin actually gone there. Looks like I'm actually going to... What am I going to do? I'm going to make a call to Wolfie here real quick. Nope, not going to work. Okay, so... let me just make sure. Setting up interview with Cal Poly. Yes, no? Hopefully yes. Take a look. Looks like I actually still have another 1,000 viewers still hanging out on the stream to watch these interviews. Thank you so much, guys. We really appreciate the support and offering you the opportunity to hear talk with us. I don't have any of their info. Let me see if I can get in touch with Matt. Maybe he can help out. Maybe we can hook something up there with those guys. Let's take a look here. People sending me stuff. Lots of people sending me stuff. But, yeah, take a look here again. You know, just one more time at the final builds. 2-1 and 12 Fiddlesticks with Azanias and the Woda. Just looking real good for his team. Graves did manage to pick up the Infinity Edge Phantom Dancer, which is a very, very scary timing on Graves. Cassiopeia did have her Abyssal Scepter and the Rabadon's Death Cap, and actually picked up a Shirelia's Reverie as well there. Kind of an interesting pickup there to see from your AP mid. But Akali did have the Gunblade. She was working towards the Rylaz, but not quite able to pick that up. And Blitz with a couple of Gulperton items. He's got the Mobis, and he actually has a Sheen along with a Chain Vest. So it looks like he was trying to go for a more aggressive build, go ahead and pick up a Trinity Force as quickly as he could and be a very, very relevant support. Obviously, when your support has 6 kills and your AD carry has only 2, you kind of have to wonder if that if that lane could maybe use just a tiny bit of adjustment. But, so... looks like we are working our way towards picking up some interviews here with Cal Poly. It's going to be kind of a roundabout way. Obviously, Wolfie's going to have to get in touch with them and then get them into Skype and all this stuff like that. So it's going to be just another minute or two. So I guess I will one last time plug all the social media. You can find me on Facebook at facebook.com/MalphusX. You can also find my stream at twitch.tv/MalphusX. There are, you know, some VODs up there, some stuff. We do a lot of community drafting, where basically I just set my status to community draft and the stream goes online, and we create a custom 5v5 game called 5v5 Draft Mocasted. Anyone can hop on in as long as you're level 30. We do have that one restriction. You have to be level 30 to play, and you have to be in good standing with us. Basically, if you like rage quit or if you're obnoxious to play with and you rage at your teammates, we'll just end up blacklisting you and you won't be playing with us anymore. But so, you know, coming community drafts, we give you links to the stream, and we just cast the game. And it's a lot of times it's educational. Sometimes we'll maybe mention something that you had never heard of before. Sometimes we'll say something that's actually wrong, and players who have much more in-depth knowledge of the champion that they're playing will sometimes be able to correct us and set us straight. And so it goes both ways there. And also, you know, it offers you an opportunity to hear yourself being casted as if you were a professional-level player at a LAN tournament. And it offers the casters an opportunity to work on our casting, work on our control of spectator mode, camera control, I mean, all sorts of good things. You know, people are trying to get better at League of Legends. It's just a matter of practice. And if you want to get better at shoutcasting, this is definitely something. If there are any, let me just take a second here. If there are any people who are starting to get interested in getting into shoutcasting, this is definitely the most beneficial thing I've done to help work on my chops as a caster, is just set up these community draft games. Big props going out to C Steve, my usual co-caster. He's the guy who came up with this idea, and you know what? It's just an absolutely fantastic way to increase your chops. So definitely, you know, that's definitely something I would recommend to anyone who's interested in getting into shoutcasting. So still just waiting on any word for the interview from Cal Poly. What was the name of the 5v5 game? We always call it 5v5 Draft Casted. Sometimes it's like 5v5 Draft Casted 30s Please or 5v5 Draft Casted Winner or something like that, but typically it always starts out 5v5 Draft Casted. So take a look. Have you added him? He accepted my Skype request. Yeah, sweet. Okay, cool. So it looks like we're going to have an interview coming up here shortly. And taking a look here. Cal Poly didn't win. Always sad that your team didn't win, but you know, someone's got to go through, and someone's unfortunately got to stay behind. I actually don't know. Let me check with Matt. Is there a third place game? That seems like that would be something cool to have, right? If we've got the finals on Saturday, maybe on Friday night if there's a third place game. When will that be? We'll have it before the finals on Saturday. Marathon? Oh, I see. Okay, cool. So it hasn't been scheduled yet. But there will be a third place game as well. So we will be seeing, this will be SUNY Stony Brook coming up against Cal Poly for the third place game. But it's kind of depend on the schedules of the teams as to when we're going to be able to make that happen. Are you interviewing Cal Poly? They are open to one. Yes, we will be interviewing them. We're just working on getting everybody into the Skype call and getting that all set up right now. It is just going to take a little bit of time here. Sorry about that, guys. So what if you consider adding me, telling me when the streams are? So I'm not too good on following web pages. You can, if you want, you can just go to twitch.tv/MalphusX and, you know, follow me there. Most of the time, if the stream comes up, it's going to be either add on Facebook. Oh, that might be something I do. I might start making like Facebook posts for when I start community drafts. That would be good, actually. Yeah, I might do that. So if you want, you can go to facebook.com/MalphusX and follow me on there. And that could also do that. Do be sure to check out the IvyLol Facebook page, facebook.com/IvyLolEsports. So much good stuff there. So much good stuff there. You find all sorts of information for when these streams are going to happen, any more, you know, when the next season's coming up, details for stuff like that. Always very good stuff there. And it's always good just to keep in touch. What else was I going to say? Oh, typically I don't do a lot of like inviting to the community drafts once they get started. I usually just like once a couple people get in, I just hop down to spectate for a couple of reasons. One, there's always it's actually reached the point now where it's becoming popular enough that there's always a lot of people that want to get in, and I have a really hard time being the jerk to like invite some people and not others. But so it's hard for me to get those invites down, and also I try to typically like get more and more people in. And if I invite the people who have been doing community drafts before, it's not spreading, it's not growing, the community isn't getting any bigger. And that's definitely something that I want. I want community drafts to be a thing that involves a lot of people. Because everyone who's ever come in and done it, as long as they haven't been like that guy that's raged, that troll that's like, we had a Vayne once that just like kept running down mid and feeding kills, just being a jerk. Other than the jerks, everyone who comes in and plays absolutely loves it, and they're always looking out for the opportunity to come back. And oh man. Should I press like or how to follow? Yeah, you can press like on Malthus X, and that way whenever I make a post, you'll be able to see it on there. And like I said, if you follow the twitch.tv channel, every time I go live, you'll get a notification. And yeah, good stuff. And I wish that I had the ability to actually moderate this channel, but I do not, sadly. When and how did you get into shoutcasting? It's actually just something that I've been kind of interested in for a while. And I just kind of reached that point where I was like, you know what? I've actually moved down to Monterey, Mexico for a job here, and the internet I got here costs about the same as the internet you would have in the States, and it's really, really fast. And I was like, you know what? If I have internet with this much upload speed, I need to just go ahead and get on it and start doing it. And so I went to the competitive events forum, and I literally emailed every tournament organizer I could find. Every single one, and just asked them, like, hey, do you already have a caster? I would really love to be involved with your event. And just started doing it that way. And like I said, got in touch with CSD. That's actually how I got in touch with CSD. He's a tournament admin for Zeke.com. And, excuse me, you know, he was like, hey, we should practice. And like, I talked with him. We decided we were going to co-cast one of the Zeke.com tournaments. He's like, hey, we should practice. We should find a way. And, you know, we set up a community draft game, and that's just where things went. But as far as how often do we do the 5v5 community games, it's really just kind of random whenever people are around. Can you get paid for doing shoutcasting? Absolutely. It's just kind of random whenever we have the opportunity and we're all set and good to go. Then it's just like, hey, let's just stream some community drafts and just have fun. So yeah, getting paid for it. I mean, the quickest way is to get a lot of followers on your channel, like your Twitch channel or stuff like that. Because if you can get your view counts up really high, then you can go to those streaming sites, Own3D or Twitch or whoever you're streaming with, and get into a content partnership with them where you can start. You'll have the ability to start running ads at your discretion, and you'll get paid based on how many people watch your ads. But of course, you know, honestly, it's just fun. Like, League of Legends is a super, super fun game. I just enjoy it that much. So, and I was trying to look for a way to get more involved. Like, I had a big goal to hit platinum. I finally hit 1900, and I was like, all right, what do I want to do now? I want to find another way to get involved, and shoutcasting is just kind of way that that's turned out for me so far. Oh, yeah. Wolfie, how long until interviews? Take a look. 950 people still sitting here listening to me rambling. Does anybody else have any questions? Do you really decline those invites one by one? No, you wait till they all stack up until finally enough of them come in and you stop getting them, and then you just start spamming the decline button all at once. It's just like, Wolfie's saying almost there. Almost there. One more player. Matt Albert saying, I can hop in and do a Q&A for Ivy Law while we're waiting. Okay, cool. Well, actually, why don't I just call you then, Matt? So everybody, I'm calling Matt Albert. He is Ivy Law Chill. And oh, actually, I'm kidding. Sorry, I called you, and then Wolfie's actually calling me right now. So why don't we both join that call? What do you say?
Sounds good.
All right. Hello.
Hello, Malthus.
Welcome to the stream, guys.
Hello.
Don't ever want to get up at once. It's okay. Well, Daz, unfortunately, you just lost in the semifinals against UT Austin. But despite that, how do you guys feel coming out of the game?
We need more practice.
Yeah, we could definitely prepare
a lot.
Well, the thing I've asked a lot of teams, did you guys do any homework before this game on the other team?
Maybe like 5 minutes before. We checked out their profile.
It's always in the custom game lobby. We look at their profiles. But other than that, no.
All right. So you guys weren't exactly sure, like, what really is the priorities to van out. You guys weren't like, oh, man, this guy's really going to terror us if he gets his hands on this.
Yeah, we saw Ryze stats. We saw. And that was kind of...
Look at the main stats, basically, and go off of that. We don't really look into it. We're already busy enough, so.
That's fair. That's fair.
Yeah, we've been unorganized lately with getting even 5 people to play.
So how did you guys feel about the Blitzcrank bottom lane? It was giving you guys a bit of a rough start in the beginning.
That second game, we were debatable about banning Blitzcrank. I think me and Alvin were, like, on the side, but I believe Nate and Scott were on the side of banning Ryze, so we just went with Ryze instead.
Yeah, that was probably a mistake.
Hindsight 2020 and all that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was all for not banning Ryze, because I'd rather have banned either Fiddle or Blitzcrank.
No, yeah, we knew we were going to first pick Janna, so we could deal with Fiddle in team fights. We just lost the game before it even got their team fights.
Actually, and I'm curious, in game one, around 23 minutes, you know, you have Nocturne kind of poking at Mordekaiser on the side brush there. Did you guys have any inkling in the back of your head that there might have been a Baron?
Not really. I knew I was going down to ward it. I was like, Fiddle can Baron. But yeah.
I think we were all oblivious to that. I have no clue why. I think there was a vision on someone's top that gave, like, that didn't, like, let me believe that they were a Baron for some reason.
Eh.
But that one just threw us off.
Yeah, because, you know, we just had an interview with UT Austin. And when you guys started doing that engagement with Mordekaiser, when he started to run down, he's like, no, and they're like, no, run the other way, Mordekaiser. Don't bring him over here. Because, you know, with Nocturne so nearby, I would have given you guys an opportunity to maybe steal that.
Yeah.
After that point, you guys did a really good job of, you know, shelling up and wasting their Baron timer. As a matter of fact, I think you guys got down finally to like 10 seconds when Blitzcrank got that hook on Ahri over the wall.
Yeah.
And it just kind of ensued downhill from there.
That was a sad hook.
Yeah. How's that work?
Otherwise, you guys were up until that single hook, you guys were playing perfectly. I was like, man, they're doing an amazing job right now, and they can actually come back from this. And it was heartbreaking to watch that hook.
Yeah, the one hook threw us off. We're like, oh damn.
So, game two, obviously, you guys, you know, first pick Janna to deal with Fiddlesticks because you know they were probably going to grab him again. Were there any other picks you guys were particularly worried about other than the obvious Blitzcrank that you chose not to ban out?
Graves, we definitely were guessing they'd pick / wanting to try to pick up ourselves if we could.
Yonda.
My opinion was that against Blitz, and I talked to my friend afterwards a bit, yeah, that we needed more like a tankier, like more aggressive support, or I was like, okay, we had Soraka first game and then we first picked Janna. Like, that was a mistake, especially if we knew that they were gonna go Blitz, because if we had Alistar or Leona, that would have been so much better. Because it's like, okay, the second game, like, I mean, I played worse as good in the first game, then in the second game though, there was not much she could do really. Caitlyn's early game damage is really weak, and it's like, so I can't really punish them. And then Blitzcrank got an early regrowth pendant, so I can't like poke him down or anything. So if we had Alistar or Leona, it would have been a lot better, because Janna had to just stay on the back, because if she got hooked, she was instantly dead, and she can't really help out much, like, because the Blitzcrank is just zoning the whole time. So
yeah, I thought was... beyond that, we've had confidence in Scott top and Clarence doing his thing mid.
Yeah, Scott usually carries games for us.
Yeah, I think they realized that by camping in top.
Yeah, yeah, that was actually, we asked them, like, you know, what was your concern when going up against this team? They're like, they're top laner.
Yeah.
Like, our plan was we're just going to camp the top lane to death.
Then,
we noticed that. We did notice that.
Yeah,
like,
I thought
it'll,
like,
top. Also, like, I mean, there was nowhere else to go, because Cassiopeia could just hold off. We try to push mid. The Gray is the bot lane already won. They could 2v2 us. So, I mean, like, there's nowhere else to go except just to, like, get, like, top, basically. Unless, like, Fiddlesticks is gonna, like, gank Ahri, but, I mean, we have, like, that basically warded, so.
And I feel like asking, because I'm curious as to, I understand why you would do it, but, you know, I want to see if there was any presence that maybe you think he has had. Clairvoyance on Lux. Did you guys feel like, you know, it brought any pressure onto the other team?
That's I don't know, Claire hasn't talked about this, because this is usually the thing he pulls off. And, like, past games, he's always pulled off his Lux Clairvoyance Flash, because it has amazing capabilities, like stealing Baron.
Yeah, I personally don't really like Ignite on Lux, because she's a really long-range mage. So, in like, later on in teamfight, she's not going to be able to get the Ignite off on the targets that she needs to hit. So that's why I take Clairvoyance instead of Ignite. Also for just checking like where Baron or Dragons, if it's getting taken, or like blue buff or red buff, if it's up, or because Lux has that long range laser, so it's good for stealing also. But Teleport's also a pretty good choice on her. It's good for ganking, but I personally like Clairvoyance the best.
Yeah, Clairvoyance was good when we wanted to invade on Fiddle.
It's the same as quite a few times.
It's mostly, yeah, it's like a preference thing for each lane, because we don't really practice much together. So it's pretty much just do whatever you're comfortable with when you're lane, and we'll like just play like standard. So, and I think it's a decent summoner spell on Lux.
All right, game two. Do you guys feel like there was any turning point where you guys were like, "This is getting out of hand. We need to sit down and just take it easy and try to farm up."
I think it was fine, except when I was bottom, and then they were at their blue or something, and then they got caught, and I don't know what was going on, but that pretty much got them the inhib and like got them like the mid towers.
I sort of saw that. Yeah, we were like behind the next on towers. Farm. That second game, we were already, like, majority of all of the lane were already behind on farm. I mean, Graves had his IE pretty early on, so.
They get, it's not even, like, necessarily from farm, because I was, like, already catching up, I think, that game, or it could have, we just dragged it out. But it was more like, they have so many towers, they get every dragon, they have Baron, like, all the, like, global gold, like, accumulates, just, like, by being on the winning team.
And I feel like I have to ask, because it was actually confirmed that UT Austin was sort of trolling when they had done it.
The Akali pick?
Specifically for Scott, how did you feel about the Akali pick top lane?
I was destroying her, except for the fact that the title kept coming top. He was top rounds like 7 times.
So, you know, you think had Fiddlesticks left you alone that you would have absolutely just rolled lane?
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, that was a mistake on my part for not being up there as much as I possibly could.
Well,
I figured it after the fourth time that he was just camping.
No, I didn't know. There was another... The point where they got the Baron was I knew they were, like, all top because we knew they were going up, that they wanted to do Baron or they wanted to just kind of cover Baron. So we knew they were all up there. And when they were, like, ganking the Akali and then the rest of the team came and then they didn't... like have enough burst to finish off Akali, and then the Nocturne and the Jax died and we couldn't stop the Baron.
Alright, Mal, this is a good opportunity to take a couple questions out of chat.
Yeah, I've been collecting some chat questions here. Awesome. One question is, did you realize what was going on with UT Austin's bans when they did them both games?
Yeah, they banned all my top three champions.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so we asked about that.
I don't really play my top three champions.
Never play Gragas in Uter, for sure.
I think they didn't want Gragas because Gragas would just, like, screw Fiddlesticks so bad with his ult, and Gragas is, like, super high burst. His ability to just displace champions. Yeah, same. I don't know. Or maybe they just thought that one of us played Gragas. I have no idea.
So, yeah, next question is, as is, obviously this is a collegiate league, people want to know what you guys are studying while you're there at Cal Poly.
Go down the list. Clarence?
if you could say your summoner name before you give the answer to the question.
I'll go, I guess. You're a scrub. I'm a computer engineer. Second year.
All right. Communist Puppy, I'm a computer science first year.
Oh my God, Scott XC, and I studied civil engineering.
That was civil engineering you said? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Brando Hoy, I'm an electrical engineer.
I'm Alvin Lau. My gamer ID is RaxonStim, and I'm a mechanical engineer first year.
Okay, cool. That's everybody, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Make sure I can count. the next question was, how did you guys, how were you able to put your team together? Was it just, did you guys just meet on the Ivy Law forums, or did some of you already know each other through solo queue, or, you know, what's the story there?
Facebook.
Facebook?
There was
the
primary people made a Facebook page, and it just branched out.
Nice. And then the last question that came out from the chat was, when they felt like it was pretty obvious that they were going to be going for the Blitzcrank pick as a support for the second game as well, what was the ideology behind not first picking Graves and taking away the potential for having that Blitz-Graves bottom lane?
Honestly, I think there was not enough discussion going into it. Because, like, I guess we just assumed that everyone wanted, like, first pick Janna, or, like, that Janna would, like, counter the Fiddlesticks, kind of.
We knew that the Blitzcrank pick was coming, the Fiddlestick was probably going to come in as well. Mm-hmm. And that's where the Janna pick derived from.
Even then, you just, I feel that it doesn't necessarily, like, even, like, counter him, because, like, Zhonya is, like, uncounterable, and, like, you could get Alistar or something. Or,
yeah, beyond
like,
that, we didn't really think too much into it.
Yeah, we didn't. There was not enough discussion going on, I think, with like the picks and bans. Because honestly, I wanted like a Fiddlesticks and a Blitzcrank ban, but then we some people like, or we noticed that they also have Ryze in their like repertoire of champions. So we decided to we chose to ban Ryze, although I was not sure about that ban, but. With the Fiddlesticks and the Blitzcrank open, because I think that really screwed up our lane. And again, like I said, I think if we picked like Alistar or Leona, that would have definitely been like kept like bot lane up.
Interesting. Another question coming in here: are you guys going to continue to play together after the third place game, after this tournament winds up?
As a team, yeah, definitely.
Probably.
We might add a couple other people because we know, I personally found out that there's a couple other really good players in our school that who don't know about the team. So we just got to go out there and find everyone basically, because we've had a couple in-game, in-school tournaments, but apparently not everyone attended, so we'll see.
Interesting.
Yeah, but we'll definitely be competing again.
Okay.
Yeah, we're all good friends, play together. Just in general, play with people from Cal Poly, get on the Facebook group, kind of just go from there.
Okay, and I'm just going to go ahead and I'm going to wrap it up with the question that I also asked to UT Austin. If you guys had to pick a series MVP from the enemy team, who would it be?
I would Blitzcrank.
Blitzcrank or Fiddle?
Blitzcrank.
Fiddlesticks,
like, sort of just did his thing, like, normally, in my opinion, like,
I would give
like typical Fiddlesticks ganks,
yeah,
I guess.
I
don't know, Fiddlesticks really knew good times to go to the objectives.
That's true, though, but we never had control of bot lane, so I mean, that's, like, pretty easy to do.
I vote Blitzcrank.
I vote Blitzcrank.
Okay, so sounds like we got a split. Okay.
Yeah, that hook literally won the first game, and then like the second game, it like caused bot lane to deteriorate.
All right, so there it is.
And he was like
prank.
6-1-2 or something.
Yeah, the second game he outkilled the AD carry by quite a bit. Graves only ended up with 2 kills and 7 assists.
Support Graves LP.
Basically. So all right, so there it is. The MVP of this series here, Blitzcrank, which was actually Donald, I believe, is the Blitzcrank player.
Yeah.
Yes, Donald.
Yeah, Donald from UT Austin picking up the MVP honors there. Very nicely done, sir.
Dolan, please.
So, yeah, you guys want to go ahead and make any shout-outs?
Thanks for everyone watching. Ivy Law's awesome league. There's a lot of good players. They deserve all the support for doing the stuff. Yeah, Scumbag Robert, yeah. Our pseudo captain, who's never doing one.
No. You and your damn groceries.
Thanks for all the fans for watching, too. And we will definitely work hard to win our third place match.
Next season, we'll see. Yes. Do it. A lot stronger than before.
Nope, no one's going to do a Mother's Day shout-out, really?
I was thinking about it. And I was like, I don't know what to do.
Hi, Mom. And then I realized my mom doesn't watch League, so...
Shout out to UC Davis players.
Happy birthday to all the mothers that aren't watching.
Wait, who was it? Who was the guys? Shout out to Pang Boy's mom, though.
Yeah. He banned his rise. That's
the least you guys can do, right?
All right, guys. That was a good series of games. I'm going to let you go now so you guys can go unwind and let Scott finish his game.
I finished.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for coming on. It was an absolute privilege to be able to watch you guys play tonight. Very, very nice games. Very, very well played. And really looking forward to seeing you in the third place game. And looking forward to seeing more of this team next season.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Yeah. Thank you.
You guys have a good night.
You too.
All right, so that call is over. I'm actually going to try one more time to see if I can get one more call with... I don't know if Danya Harold is still around, but I'm going to try to call Danya Harold and Wolfie here real quick so we can get like just one last good night from all of us. Let's take a look here. Who's sending me messages? Okay, Daniel. Yep, cool. Oh, he's still on stream too. Awesome. Okay, so let me find a way to make this work. This is a lot more people than I want. Actually, I'm just going to do... Yeah, nope, that's not it either. All right, you know what? Here. Call Danya. Go ahead and get this going up here. And then as soon as I have him called, I will call CJ as well. Danya, if you're listening to the stream right now, I'm calling you on Skype. Please pick up. Please? Yep, there he is. Hey, man.
I had to get my stuff set back up again. I'd actually broken it all down already.
Oh, sorry about that. And actually, Wolfie, if you're watching the stream as well, if you could set your Skype status to online so that I may call you.
Yeah, like I was trying to contact Wolfie earlier, and he was not there. It was really confusing.
Let's try this and see. Okay, cool. It looks like I'm actually able to do it. And there we go. We have everybody. So if you guys want to go ahead, I'll give you an opportunity to say good night and sign off the stream, and then I will close it all off.
All right, yeah, just thank you to everyone who stuck with us through all of this. You know, we at one point had 4,500 people, and that's kind of awesome. It's a new personal high for me. And so, you know, thank you to everyone who tuned in. I hope you really enjoyed it. And for those of you who wanted to do a community draft afterwards, actually, we are going to try and do one of those. At least I'm going to. And, you know, I'm sure, you know, I'm not sure if Malph is going to stick around, but I think Wolfie might. So, you know, we're going to try and do one of those at least before we call it an evening. You know, I'm waiting on my laundry, so I've got a little bit of time to kill. So
yeah, Wolfie, you want to say good evening to all the folks out there?
Well, of course, I'd love to. All these amazing people that have stuck around for the player interviews, and of course, got to enjoy those really amazing games with us as well. I am Dire Wolfley. I've been shoutcasting for Ivy Lowe for quite some time, so if you guys are interested in seeing a couple of the games that happened this season, just go on to my stream channel, own.tv/DireWolfley, and you can go check out a bunch of games there. I also casted all the games for the Ivy Lowe Spring Fling Tournament, which was a lot of fun. It was really amazing, so you know, if you want to go catch up and prepare yourselves for Season 2, you know, aside from obviously registering a team and playing yourself, go check out a couple of videos. And of course, always keep an eye out and tune in for whenever you can. So that just leaves you, Malthus.
Actually, we do have Ivy Law Chill here with us on the call as well. Take it away, Matt.
Hey, just want to say if you guys have any questions, I will be in IRC chat for a while. Also, we are having a Ivy Law admin combination shoutcaster versus community game if you guys want to take us on. It's kind of like a Ivy Law tradition that goes back to, I think, last summer when we just had like one tournament and we just played with all these other people and got our butts whooped game after game after game and had so much fun. So if you guys want to join, I will put the lobby name for the custom game in chat and the password is on our Twitter feed. So hopefully we'll see you guys in there.
So there it is. And I'm going to go ahead and just close this all down. I am Alphas X. Thank you all so much for tuning into the stream tonight. Fantastic games coming out of the hands of Cal Poly and UT Austin. Congratulations once again to UT Austin for making it through to the finals. We will be seeing them on Saturday. And we also will be having a third place game before that, but it's all going to come down to the team scheduling and when we're actually going to be able to have everything set up. So do, you know, check out ivylaw.com. That's where you can be able to find that information. Also the Facebook page, facebook.com/ivylawesports. Once again, you know, twitch.tv/MalphusX, facebook.com/MalphusX, own.tv/DanyaHerald, own.tv/... Dire Wolfie, sorry. I'm
it's
losing
okay.
my mind here at the end.
Hey, it's okay.
You know, check all this stuff out. Be involved. Keep yourself apprised of what's going on. And you know what? Can't wait to see you guys for the next games. Thank you so much once again for watching. Have a fantastic night, everyone.